Welcome to the board for votes. We do have a quorum, just barely. Four is required, so we do have that. First item would be the minutes of the meeting. You should have received them in your package. Are there any questions on the minutes that were received? If not, do I have, I would entertain a motion.
So moved.
A second?
Second.
It has been moved and seconded to accept the minutes as presented. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? We'll accept the minutes. We have some correspondence in front of us. We have a letter from Chief David Pickering concerning site distances at Ocean House Road, and we have a letter from Mr. Albert Frick. I also would like to draw your attention to a memo from Steve Butler, who, by the way, I got a message from yesterday that he was not going to be able to make it tonight. So we will be without the services of our planner tonight. And that would be a memo from Steve on Catherine Violet's daycare center site plan. And I don't know what else we have in our package that does not directly relate to the agenda, but there might be some other things in here. On the question of site distances, I have drafted a letter. This is taking things a little bit out of order, but I have drafted a letter on that subject to the town council. This was after our review meeting a week or so ago. I thought it might be a good idea. We've had a lot of discussion of the intersection at 77 Scott Dyer Road and Shore Road. I think that the town council should be considering some planning activity in that area. And if I could just read the text of this memo to the town council, if it's acceptable, I would turn it over to Jane to get typed and sent up. This would be to the town council, I dated it August 16th, from Ivan Most, Vice Chairman, Planning Board. Subject, intersection of Route 77, Scott Dyer Road and Shore Road. We have had two applications in recent months for commercial development in the vicinity of this main intersection at Pond Cove. It is the opinion of the Planning Board that a traffic analysis is required to determine whether revised road striping or traffic lights are needed to facilitate the increased use. We recommend providing professional services to review this matter. Are there any additions, corrections to this letter? I don't know if I have to get a vote on it, but if it's acceptable, I'd like to send it up to the town council. Okay. Okie doke. First item on our formal agenda is Spinnaker Heights. Minor subdivision review. We have received a request on that item to table this to our September meeting. So I guess at this point I'd like to entertain a motion to table on Spinnaker Heights minor subdivision review.
Mr. Chairman, before we do that, what was the reason for the request for tabling? Was it from the applicant?
If I may.
Yes.
There was a letter.
It was a letter, yeah. I'm not sure I've got the right one here. Let me just make sure I've got the right one. This isn't it right here, is it? You got it?
Oh, it's white.
That's the one.
Is that the Ed Hollage?
That's the Ed Hollage. Okay, it's a letter from Edward W. Hollage. Would you like me to read the text of the letter? It's very short. It's directed to Alice Rand. I had an occasion to speak to Gary Cummins at the conclusion of the Spinnaker Heights public hearing last week regarding the brooks on the site. He felt that I overreacted to the brook, which flows around. Shortly agreed, as was presented, that the brook. No, this is not it, I don't think. That's not it. This is not from me.
It was a letter of Alice from
Dr. Owens requesting that they table.
Okay, that was my question.
It's not in our package.
No, it came from the applicant, right.
Yeah.
I would move we table till the September meeting.
Okay, any second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? We will now table Spinnaker Heights and move on to Gullcrest Farm. Bringing us up to date on Gullcrest, we are, at this point in time, going to be considering tonight the wetlands alteration permit and issue of completeness on that. We are going to table the preliminary approval to the September meeting. So I guess item one on that sub-item would be an action to table on the preliminary plan approval, and that is under request from the applicant to the September meeting. And we'll act on completeness for the wetlands alteration permit tonight. So do I have a motion on the tabling of that?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, then we will table that application to the September meeting and schedule it at that time. And we'll move on to the wetlands alteration permit. Could the applicant make a presentation?
Ivan, could I just be sure that the record reflects that I'm not voting on Gullcrest Farm matters? Because I think Jane's minutes will show that I'm here.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm not mistaken, someone in my office still has some advisory capacity for you.
Oh, yes.
Okay.
Okay, so we'll show on the record.
I'll just listen.
Dan has excused himself from this item on the agenda. Will you please identify yourself for the record, sir?
Good evening, Mr. Chairman. I'm Robert Bruce, associated with Brown Homes on this project.
Mm-hmm.
And Dana Levitt of Whitman & Howard is with me, as is Earl Brown of Brown Homes. One minor housekeeping matter before we go on to this. At the workshop, we were asked to get a clarification of Mr. Bosenhart, the regional wildlife biologist's recommendation that there be a 250-foot setback in certain wetlands. Mr. Bosenhart has written to us, and he's identified those wetlands as the marshes which surround the Spurwink River. He's described them in the letter with a map, and I'd like to file those with the...
We don't currently have those in our packages?
No, this is a letter dated August 9th, and we'll get those. I'll give you additional copies.
So that answers the question on the 250-foot buffer.
Yes.
Is the board clear on this point? We're sure? Okay. And we'll labor it then.
Now we ask the board to make a determination of completeness on our application for a wetlands alteration permit. The filing is complete. Everything is before the board, and it's our understanding that we're in full compliance.
We have received a checkoff list dated August 5th. I draw your attention to a memo from Steve Butler dated August 5th, Gullcrest Farm request for wetlands alteration permit. Every item on that list is indicated as okay. So we do have a complete application. Once again, this is only to determine application completeness. If there is any question on that, we should raise that right now. Otherwise, we will be setting the date for a public hearing at our next meeting. If I'm not mistaken, under our ordinances, we do have to set that within 30 days. So are there any questions on the package as it's been received? I have one question, and it came up in our review. It's my understanding that on the map that shows wetlands, and I'll draw the attention of the board to this map right here. The wetlands that are disturbed are based on a determination of all three characteristics of wetlands being in place. Is that the way you understand it's been done?
Yes, in our most recent filing, those are I'm not sure what you have before. Yes, I think that's it. There is another map that was filed at the same time with that, and it shows In the dark shaded areas, it shows the wetlands that meet the Corps of Engineers definition, where the three different tests overlap. There's another place on the map where it shows all of the wetlands under the Cumberland County Soils Survey System, and the other wetlands, and that completes the identification of the wetlands on it. So they're all identified, and our current plan is superimposed upon that wetland. So.
You should.
I don't think on the one that you have.
No, it's not. We did do, Steve Butler did at an earlier meeting. Unfortunately, he's not here tonight to go over it. But he had made a comparison with the soils maps. And a lot of the areas that are shown here as not being disturbed actually are in soils that are wetland soils.
Yes.
So this is once again going on the supposition of one criteria versus three, I realize. But just so you'll know that this question may come up, there is a question of which way do we go on this one. So if you take a look at the soils, and there is a lot of Sebago monkey peat in this area, you have a lot of wetland soils.
Now, there's no Sebago monkey peat is being disturbed. That is the, those are what I think of as the circular 39 soil. Uh-huh. None of those are being disturbed. That's a different category of wetlands. Mm. Throughout the project, there are wetlands, and I wish there were different words to describe each of these kinds of wetlands, but there are wetlands as identified in the Cumberland County Soils criteria. And those are the wetlands, other than black shaded areas, those are the wetlands that are being altered and which require a permit. Mm-hmm. And now, and those are carefully identified on the sheet that we submitted.
Okay.
Now, those aren't the prohibited type of wetland. You can build on those, and we would expect to be able to build them and disturb them, but only pursuant to your directions.
Okay. Just so you'll understand, there is some discussion ongoing on this matter, and it would be a good idea, I think, if you haven't discussed it with Steve at some point in time, to take a look at what he's done with a similar map that we don't have here tonight, just to get his input on what he's considering.
We would expect there would be no prohibition against disturbing those soils, only that the disturbance of those soils must be carefully mm-hmm. controlled and monitored by the board.
Mm-hmm. Okay, there was a question I thought early on the net acreage allowable based on soils types that are used. Is that a question that we want to bring up at this time or not?
Well, we have measured the net residential
acreage. Has that been recalculated?
And yes, and all of our figures have been submitted. And if there's quite a margin of safety there. And so I don't anticipate a problem with that unless there's some rule that we've never heard of that's being applied.
But that has been submitted.
Oh yes, okay. That's been submitted and we've given the details.
Okay. Yeah.
The next meeting will be on 30 days.
It will be.
Next meeting is going to be September 20. I think it's more than 30 days. Should we vote as a can you set the public hearing now, or can you? Do you have to?
If I understand the problem, we'd be willing to state to the board that we'll waive those additional days as required by the zoning bylaw.
Okay.
The next meeting isn't until then.
The question is, the next regularly scheduled meeting of the planning board is September 20th, and that would be in excess of 30 days. So the applicant is indicating that he will waive that requirement.
The problem comes from where the first Tuesday falls, and I think it falls
exactly.
The first of the month.
First and third.
Yeah.
Okay. If there are no other questions on this package.
Could I make, it seems I had a lot of these here, and they also were dated July 88, and it's one of one. But there are two different maps, evidently, in this stuff they delivered me, and it was not designated as different. So I may have some of them here that the board has not received.
Oh, okay. I know they were filed.
I received them, but he's got a different one there.
Yeah, I received one that says sheet one of one,
and
July
88. And they all do.
That is different. Yeah.
There's one that shows the wetlands, and then there's one that shows the soils.
Okay, I never
okay,
see that.
Okay, that's my error, that it didn't blow out. I just didn't know there was a
yes,
difference
the soil.
Between the
okay. I've said wetlands. I mean soils, and then some of those soils are designated as wetlands under the Cumberland County Survey.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman?
Yeah.
Just a question. Since you are requesting that we table the preliminary plan approval, are there going to be any changes in what we have for the alterations of wetlands before us tonight? Because I have a packet here about 10 inches high, and I'm so mixed up at this point, I don't know what we're doing. So the map that I studied this week, are those definite wetland alterations that you have planned for this?
Yes, the one that we filed on the last filing date. Now, a lot of the other plans, as you know, have to be amended because
yes.
of the changes. And those will be filed at the next filing
date. I see.
And then you push everything else to one side and concentrate only on the new charts that we filed on.
Once again, your net acreage calculations is based on your latest plan.
No, those have never changed.
Those have not changed.
Those have been the same since day one. That's a constant.
Okay.
And unless there is some difference of opinion, but I think that's the exact science, the measurement of those. At least okay. that's been
so that hasn't changed. Changed, is what you're saying?
No, those have okay. not changed.
All right.
Mr. Chairman?
Yeah.
My understanding of the wetlands alteration permit is that the town planner has indicated that the information is complete. With a couple of questions, one raised by you as to the definition of what wetlands are, and also a question about a recommended setback from Spurwick River. Those are issues that I don't think go to the completeness of the application. There is
right.
information submitted, whether it's adequate or not for positive finding or whatever finding of the board is still subject to question, which presumably we'd be handling after the public hearing and as a part of the action of the board. With those words, I guess I would move that we find the wetlands alteration permit application under section 19.39 complete. And set for public hearing at our September 20th meeting at 7:05.
I would second that.
Okay. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, we'll go to a vote. And by the way, I would like you to modify that 7:05 because we may end up putting it on at 7:05, but then again, we may not. We'd like to keep the flexibility on exact agenda. Items until a little bit before that meeting, if that's okay. If we just say for our September 20th meeting, there may be something that has to come in at 7:05. It's not that. That's all I'm
saying. Sounds fine to me.
Okay.
I would amend the motion to eliminate the 7:05.
Great. Okay.
I second that too.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? We have a complete application, and we'll see you at a hearing on September 20th. Time to be determined. We're a little bit ahead of schedule. We're quite a bit ahead of schedule. Is Mr. Griffin here by any chance? Great. Mind going on a little bit earlier? Okay. We're into a site plan review on a application for a dry cleaner at the Pond Cove intersection.
My name is John Griffin. I am the applicant. I was before the Pine Board at the last meeting, and the site plan that I have brought forward is the revised one that I think everyone has in their package. The original plan that I had some alterations as requested by T.Y. Lynn, the town engineer. And basically, the difference was on the parking here was diagonal, and the letter from T.Y. Lynn and their engineers and Steve Butler felt that it should be straight at 90-degree angle. Also, he didn't feel there was sufficient space between here and here if it was turned 90-degree diagonal for the parking and backing out of the parking spaces. And he has since added the requested footage. I was before the Board of Appeals, and the variances I requested were for parking and setbacks of a building. That was granted on May 24th. And one of the concerns that was addressed was on the Hennessy project, which is next door. There was a great deal of concern as far as the private right-of-way that ran behind the property, which is here, and served Hennessy, Jerry Murray and his family, which sets back here, and this property. I had no desire to utilize that as a separate entrance. The only impact that we would have on it would be that it's and maybe I should read you the ruling from the on the variance from the appeals board. And they provided for the second story. They granted me the setback, provided for the second story. And the second story will be used only for storage, that the family employee parking will be in the rear of the property, and that the proposed laundromat dry cleaning facility will not ever be self-service. That was one of the conditions. The nearest residential area is 137 feet from this property. And we have provided, this is a site review, and we have provided extensive information as far as buffering, landscaping, and Owen Haskell did the site work and addressed the storm water runoff and on a 2-year storm and a 25-year storm. And the and feels that there is no problem. At the last meeting, there were, I think, a couple of questions. The main concerns, I think, were site distances and traffic impact. Since that meeting, the report from T.Y. Lynn that addressed it on the on their letter dated July 8th stated on under Article 2, refer page 3, site distance. The town's site distance requirements are met, but just barely. Site distance can be improved with the removal of the 20-inch maple tree if the town feels the distance is necessary. One thing that did come up was a question of what was the traveled way and measuring site distances. The site distances are totally accurate because they were done by Owen Haskell in conjunction with Bill Bray, who is a traffic engineer and has done the traffic study for this project. And also they were confirmed by T.Y. Lynn, who is the town engineer. The problem arose in the definition of what is a traveled way. And I'm going to let Bill Bray explain this part of it, because in the original study that he did it in conjunction with T.Y. Lynn and the town engineer. So, Bill?
Good evening. In my report, which was dated June 27th...
Sir, would you identify yourself for the record, please?
Excuse me. I'm Bill Bray, registered engineer and representing Mr. Griffin for the traffic report that was prepared for this project.
Thank you.
In my report, on page 2, I have defined how I measured site distance for this particular project, knowing that there was a site restriction simply by field review. I contacted T.Y. Lynn, who is the town engineer, and asked for an interpretation on the town standards in regards to where I should determine the measurement point in consideration of the bike lane that's presently striped along Route 77. At that time, I was given the information that the measurement point is calculated from the edge of the travelway, in this case, which would be the white striped line in the roadway that separates the vehicle movement lane from the bike lane. And again, using the town standards, if an unavoidable obstruction is in the iPath, then one can adjust the measurement point from a 15-foot setback to a 10-foot setback. Using that measuring point, 10 feet from the edge of travelway, on three different occasions, with the assistance, as Mr. Griffin had indicated, with Owen Haskell, we were able to measure vehicle sight lines looking left from the proposed driveway in excess of 385 feet, which is the existing speed limit, 35 miles per hour, times the factor, again referenced in your town standards, of 10% over that posted speed limit. Measurements to the right, with implementation of the improvements that were recommended in a traffic study prepared for the Hennessy project, sight lines in excess of 400 feet will be provided with completion of those improvements. Based on that, I feel, and I believe it's been concurred with by T.Y. Lynn, that there is adequate sight lines for this project, both left and right of the driveway, in accordance with the town standards. I'd be happy to try to answer any questions that the board may have, if it's appropriate.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Bray, I can understand what you just said. However, let's take a hypothetical situation of a bicycle in that bicycle lane. How far would a vehicle exiting that driveway, how far can a vehicle see left for any potential bicycle that is in that way? Is there a good sight distance for that as well, since you just indicated that the vehicle has to proceed through the bikeway, do I understand what you said, to the vehicular line? So can a vehicle exiting from that driveway see far enough left to see a bicyclist coming?
Let me try to explain my definition of where I measured from, I may have confused you in how I described that. If you measure 10 feet back from the white line that's in the pavement, now that designated the outside edge of the bike path, you would come back 10 feet from that point, which would put you approximately 2 feet into the existing sidewalk. The point of measurement would be in back of where the actual travel path of the bicyclist would be. Not knowing exactly where that bicyclist would be in relationship to that bicycle lane, there is at least 200 feet of sight distance, regardless of where that measurement was taken. And keeping in mind that the bicycle approaches at a much slower speed than the posted speed limit, which is 35 miles an hour, I would make the assumption, without, again, going out and making accurate measurements, that there would be sufficient sight lines for that vehicle operator pulling out of the driveway to observe a bicycle approaching with sufficient time to avoid a collision with the bicyclist.
And how about the bicyclist?
They also would have sufficient time, again, keeping in mind that they're approaching at a much reduced speed than what the motor vehicle would be doing on the street with approach speeds in, you know, in the neighborhood of 35 miles an hour. The typical bicyclist is probably traveling between 5 and 15 miles an hour at that particular point.
Is the maple tree on that, on the left-hand side of the exit?
Yes, it is. There's actually two trees. There is only one tree, the furthest tree from the driveway, that restricts the sight line. It's a 28-inch maple tree, and I'm not a forestry major, but at least from looking at the appearance of the tree, it's in excellent shape and a very attractive tree. And naturally, with its removal, the sight lines would be, you know, much greater than what they are. But based on my measurements and concurred by T.Y. Lynn, there are adequate sight lines by leaving the tree there.
Thank you, Mr. Bray.
Yes, ma'am.
Any other questions?
Yeah, I just want to be sure I understand. Can you hear me okay? You're saying normally you would drop back 15 feet from the edge of the vehicular way into
That's
the
correct.
Driveway.
That's correct.
And there you measure the distance.
That's correct.
There's this 10-foot potential distance that you have with an unreasonable object.
That's right.
And if you begin, if you measure back from the outer edge of the bike path, part that's closest to the middle of the road, even taking the 10 feet, you still get into the driveway but by a couple feet?
Correct. I'm behind the edge of pavement by 2 feet. The bike path at that particular point is 8 feet wide. And if you add another 2 feet, which would give you the 10 feet, then I would actually, I'm actually measuring behind the edge of pavement.
What can be done about that concern. Is this a situation of something we've done to increase the site distance, or is it sort of an all or nothing situation?
Well, in this particular case, it is a town tree, or at least it's located within the public right-of-way. In all honesty, the only way you can improve the sight lines at the measurement point, if you will, at 15 feet, would be removal of that 28-inch tree.
What would happen if some sort of a stop sign was placed farther down the driveway so that you had to stop before the driveway? Is there enough room to see on the inside of the tree?
No, because there's a fence located on the property at the corner of the intersection, and there are a number of mailboxes and bushes and shrubs in the way that actually restrict the sight line even more the further you pull back into the driveway. And also keep in mind that Route 77 is on a horizontal curve as it approaches the site, so the further you move, or the further away from the edge of pavement you move, you're actually pushing yourself back onto the inside of the curve, and you continually reduce that sight line.
I didn't bring my whole file with me, and I apologize. Is there another way out?
Possibly, if there was a concern, you could paint a supplemental white line about a foot off of the edge of pavement, which would indicate which is typically referred to as an edge line, that would clearly delineate where the bike lane is and hopefully keep the bicyclist away from the edge of pavement, possibly again reducing the potential of a conflict if you would. But in all honesty, I really truly believe that there is more than ample sight line for both the bicyclist and the motor vehicleist coming out of the driveway to see one another before a collision would occur. I believe this is the only possibility for access to the site. I apologize. I thought you were referring to.
Your answer was the
Dan, there is another exit which we went through on the Hennessy property,
that's
but that's not really a legal turn. There's not any way you can make a legal turn coming out of there, I believe, to the left.
That's correct. You have to make a right turn, and you can only make a right turn in and a right turn out because of the channelization island that's presently in the middle of Scott Dyer Road.
I have a concern, wholly apart from this application, two concerns. One is that QILN is interpreting, basically making decisions up to us to make, which is how the ordinance is going to be interpreted, especially when they say, we couldn't find anything, so here's the way it ought to be interpreted. I think at that point it's clearly the province of the planning board. Secondly, can't park in this application. I think it's a dangerous precedent to not treat the bike path with the kind of respect that it ought to be treated. There's one patrolman who probably knows the area as well as anybody has the same concern. I don't know how we address it in the context of this application, but I for one would, if I didn't reject TYLN's interpretation, say that I certainly don't consider it as anything that should bind us.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Chairman, can I ask a couple of questions of
sure.
Mr. Gray? With the site distance that's been determined by the town engineer, and that's basically 10 feet back from the sideline of the vehicular travel way, what is the speed limit of the road, and what is the required site distance, and what is there for site distance at that point?
Okay, the town, the posted speed limit on Route 77 at that point is 35 miles per hour. Mm-hmm. Without going out and taking actual speed measurements, the ordinance states that you can multiply the 35 miles an hour by 110% and use that times 10 feet to come up with the required sight line measurement, which would be in this case 385 feet. The town ordinance also calls for a measurement point 385 feet. Town ordinance also calls for the measuring point to be 10 feet from the travelway. And with that, I was able to achieve a measurement between 380 and 400 feet.
Left and right?
To the right, it actually exceeds 400 feet, with the improvements recommended in the Mr. Hennessy report.
In this case, the travel way being from the bike path line,
that's
not
correct.
From the curb.
That's correct.
And if you went from the curb, you would not have that much sight distance, right?
That's correct.
By bike path line, you mean the
older line.
But again, there is only one travel lane on Route 77. It's designed, and because of the pavement mark, and there is a single travel lane in each direction, the remainder of the pavement is used by the bike lane, or it could actually be referred to as a breakdown lane.
Mr. Chairman, one other question. If that tree were taken down, what would that provide for sight distances?
Well, it's very difficult to give you an exact measurement because I haven't figured out yet how I can measure around a tree, but I would guess that you would be in the neighborhood of 450 to 500 feet.
So a significant increase. And that's
yes,
left, left view.
That's correct. And keeping in mind that the profile of Route 77 at the intersection drops down as it leaves the intersection, so without going out and measuring that vertical drop, I would guess it would be in the neighborhood of 450 to 500 feet.
Dick, are you finished? You alluded to improvements that were planned in the Hennessy application. Are you talking about the removal of the ledge?
That's correct.
Okay, so that's in view to the right.
That's right. If
so
the ledge is not if the ledge is not removed in accordance with that report, then there would also be a site restriction to the right.
To the right. So really, your application here depends upon step one being that the Hennessy application goes through with what they're doing.
That's correct.
Board clear on that point?
The most of that ledge is already done.
Yeah, I've noticed the work is in progress there.
Yeah. And that was a restriction that we had within Mr. Hennessy's application.
Right.
Okay. So we presume that that's going to be accomplished.
Right. I think we have to presume that's a given.
Mr. Chairman,
yeah.
Have you discussed with Mr. Hennessy working out perhaps one curb cut for both businesses to share, which would make it less complicated and probably safer?
Well, we did discuss it, but Tom Hennessy felt that it would complicate, as you probably well aware, the deed and the restrictions on the deed, and it would go with the property.
Mm-hmm.
So it would, any time you enter into that type of agreement, it kind of complicates the deed to the property.
I see.
He felt that he already has it, okay, so he felt that he could leave it the way it is. I know his original request was to run his driveway straight through to the back.
Yeah.
And because of the intersection of Scott Dyer Road and the private way, where the island was in the middle of that
road. Yeah.
And I think the restrictions put on, I think there's a barrier, which was a fence, and it will not, and the only parking back there would be installed for one to its support.
Right. Well, I think, Mr. Chairman, that we definitely have to go and see this, but you know, two curb cuts in that particular area with the bicycle path is of great concern to me. But I mean, it's not your fault. I just wish that we had planned for our business area, planned ahead, you know.
Well, I probably would have gone to the right. There's this thing called a big rock there.
Yeah, I've seen it.
It's very expensive, as Mr. Hennessy found out when he removed the end, and I removed some of it when I put in the sewer from the highway. I certainly didn't want to suggest removing that maple tree because, it, as Bill said, it is a healthy tree. But then again, if that is the only way that we can assure the site distances, I would request that I be allowed to remove it.
I just want to repeat for the benefit of some planning board members who might have arrived late, I entered into correspondence a memo to the town council concerning requests for planning services for that intersection, so that the, so we could get some town help in terms of taking a look at that overall intersection and the problems that are beginning to surface as commercial development starts to take place in that area. So hopefully we will get some, if the town council agrees to employ somebody, we will get some overall looking at that. As pertains to this particular application, though, I think that we had discussed the concept, and I've got in some of my preliminary notes a question mark of a hearing. And I think at this point in time, it's something that the board should consider setting a time for a site visit and a hearing on this one. This is a commercial area application. We have not advertised it as such, and so therefore we haven't really gotten the input of the public on this one. And it will be my opinion only that, and you can take it as that, that I think that that would be a mistake not to have a hearing and review this through through a public process. Do any of the other planning board members have any thoughts on this?
Mr. Chairman.
Yeah.
If I may, I realize that the planning board can require or request a public hearing at any time they feel that it's necessary. It is not required under the site review.
That's right.
There was a public hearing on the variances before the Board of Appeal,
mm-hmm.
and there was no one speaking against it, and there were some people there. I have spoken to my only, Mr. Hennessy and Jerry Mary are the only two abutters, and Mr. Mary I've spoken to, and he has no problem with it.
Mm-hmm.
And Mr. Hennessy does. I can see the concern of the town and the planning board when something comes up that isn't really addressed in the statutes or the ordinances. And it certainly is a good idea to take a look at it. But I would submit that I submitted my proposal under the existing ordinances and rules and regulations that existed. And in all honesty and forthrightness, and the old cliche, time is money,
mm-hmm.
and I've been invested, I've turned a spade in soil, I've invested a considerable amount of money. More delay is going to cost. It's like sitting there in a taxi with a meter running and not knowing when you're going to get to the destination. I would ask for consideration from the planning board.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I guess I agree with that in terms of the public hearing. In terms of taking a look at the project and the property, I think it may be appropriate to look at that piece of property. I have a suggestion for that in a few moments. It's not too dark. But the real question is one of site distances. That's what we're dealing with. It's not a use of a property that's inappropriate for a business zone. It's really a question of the site distance to the left coming out of the property, and the stumbling block and barrier, if there is one, truly appears to be under town control. So sitting here as the town board, if we have a tree that's in the way for site distances or safety problems, I think it's inherent on the town to take some action. And that action might be to decide to leave the tree there and it's not a safety problem, or to take down the tree if it is a safety problem. My suggestion is one that the property is about a 1 minute walk away from here. We are ahead of ourselves on the agenda, and I was going to suggest or request that we take a break anyway before Mr. Balfour's application, anticipating that there may be some people who want to listen to that application process and feeling that we shouldn't really start that before 8:15. If it's appropriate, I'd ask the board to take 5 minutes, and maybe we could walk across and take a look at this property, take a look at the tree in question, and come back and deal with it right now.
I think that's an excellent suggestion. If we did that now and delayed the question of a hearing afterwards, it might beat the clock as far as darkness is concerned. So I guess Mr. Tinsman is suggesting is a mini sidewalk right now. How does that hit the board?
Great.
Okay, I guess what I would do is declare a recess at this point in time for approximately, for the purposes of the people that are here, I would say 20 minutes. We should be able to accomplish this by 8:10. Does that sound about right? And we'll be back in at 8:10 and start back up again at 8:15.
Do we have any indication that the Belcourt application isn't going to be heard? I don't see any.
No.
No, it's going to be here.
It's time for 8:20.
It's time for 8:20 on the agenda.
Yes.
Yeah. So if, I don't think we have to take a vote on this, do we?
Be okay. Careful crossing the street.
Yeah, well, let's not lose anybody. We're close to a quorum.
I certainly thank the board for that. No.
Still got a way cheaper than renting a space in a lot.
Is that right?
Oh, yeah. It would average about $20 a month. Mm-hmm. I'd pick up about $4 a month. So I'm going to have to. If I could just get to the point where I'm not stressed out, it was $65 a
month. Yeah.
Yeah.
I know mine.
Yeah.
That's what you're doing.
That's what
I'm doing. Half in garage and they can even
done it. Mm-hmm. You heard it?
Mm-hmm.
How does she have a car for other than getting a car ripped off?
She likes it.
She likes it. Mm-hmm. My daughter's living here, so you know, she's a good financial something about
it.
In Florida, she's got an apartment on Maple Street.
Yeah.
And they're doing that. So we're going to get this for best of all.
Yeah.
All
right, now
for engineers, it doesn't make any difference.
Yeah. No, they outstate the firm.
Yeah. I think she had a local perspective from that.
I think she's
going to
be a local
perspective.
Within 2 years. Yeah. Between 2 years. She just moved into the end of the month, she's going to move to West Hatch.
Yeah.
Marsh, that's where you have to go.
Yeah, I should go to the boom. Thank you. Boom's here, it's near, it's next one beyond West Hatch. It's a nice area.
All of us that live in there.
I go by there often, I go to visit the trip city drive, I'm waiting for a retreat. I'll suggest it.
Well, as you're going down, you know the three big pink buildings on your left there, you go by, like, those is that first pink building. Tax consultants.
Must be hard to get used to.
Hmm?
Must be hard to get used to at that 21st floor.
I would think so.
You look your kid over there.
If I could convince the planning board members to return here to the podium, we'll get started again. If they're outdoors, maybe somebody could grab them. If we could go back at, I said that we'd try to reconvene around 8:15, so that we're all back here, maybe we could get back on board. Where we left off, we took a tour across the street and took a look at the property that's in question, and I have, I think, a better idea of the site distance situation. What we have before us is a question on where we go from here with this review. It does not require a hearing. Some of the planning board members have expressed an opinion against a hearing. Some have expressed an opinion for. I guess I'd like to hear from the rest of the planning board members as to what their thoughts are on the subject of taking this process forward. Are there any other thoughts on the matter?
Mr. Chairman, I am not in favor of having a public hearing on it, and I think that we should ask Mr. Bray and Mr. Griffin to investigate some alternatives to exiting their driveway, whether it be signs, speed bumps, markings in the driveway, and try and come up with some ways to deal with the problem that we're facing.
Okay. As a point of order here, if we decide not to have a hearing, does that mean we go into approval or disapproval of the plan is presented at this point tonight?
Good.
That's not in the program, but I guess you could.
I mean, if we don't have a hearing, I guess that would, what would be the purpose of waiting a month, I guess would be the question.
Mr. Chairman, I've got a suggestion to make, and it involves site distance. As we went out there, it appears to me that, if I might, that the site distances can be met in line with the engineer's remarks of where the site distances are measured from. Concern by at least one planning board member that's already been expressed, and I think I share that, is that it's very similar to what Officer Dyer has indicated, that when you put your eye at that point, the vehicle is going to be in the bike path. I guess I also share an opinion that Mr. Bray cited a few moments ago, that bikes move slower than cars. If you needed sight distances for the bicycles, it would be far greater than it would be for a vehicle moving 35 miles an hour. So I'm not sure that it's really a question of safety in terms of seeing a bicycle and moving into the bike path, or the bicycle seeing the vehicle and moving in front of it. It's more of a question of where that vehicle has to be stopped in order to get the 350 to 400 feet of sight distance to see the vehicles traveling down the road. And if that person's vehicle has to be in the bike path, and that causes an obstruction to the bike path that wouldn't otherwise be there if the business wasn't there. When we went out and looked at the stopping location where the sight distance was measured from, and we moved back in the driveway, a couple of things were apparent. That a sight walk, if you will, informal or formal, helps a great deal to understand. And that was that there are two trees, really, to me, that are in question. Not if you take the sight distance location from the point where the vehicle has to be in the bike path, but if you move back. There are two trees, and one of those trees has branches that reach out toward the street. And there are two of them. And the applicant indicated on the sight walk that the pole, the telephone pole that exists right where the middle of the driveway would be, would have to be relocated. When the relocation exists or occurs, that CMP has indicated that they're going to have to trim that tree that, to me, is in question with the branches that reach up toward the street. What I would suggest is an alternative to what we're talking about, and I've already expressed my opinion on a public hearing. I think that the public hearing may be inappropriate by its location and the nature of the property and the fact that it's an existing building that wants to turn to business. But I do have the suggestion that we take Mr. Boxer's idea, and that is to move the sight distance back, or stopping line back, to a point where the vehicle is clearly not in the bike path. And that we require, as a planning board, as a part of our approval process, that those two limbs be severed, leaving still a main trunk of the tree, but the limbs that are coming out toward Route 77 be taken off. And that, as a condition of the approval, that the applicant get the town's permission to do that. And that the town be satisfied then with the site distances that exist. That's our national bird.
You got to belay while we get rid of the mosquito.
Down the other hand.
Thanks.
Thank you. In being out there looking down, I think that that would resolve a lot of the issues. I don't think that there's a safety issue, because we do have the sight distances. I think that there are obstructions. I think we should move the line back and force the removal of those limbs.
Mr. Chairman, if we do that, then looking to the left, as Mr. Bray has indicated, we'll encounter a problem with the sight distance to the right as you're looking out of the driveway, won't we, Mr. Bray?
Will there be sufficient ledge removed to solve that problem, I guess is the question.
As the ledge is right now, there is not. It hasn't been completed, it's my understanding. With removal back to the property line, which was recommended in my report, there would be, if I recall correctly, a line of measurement 30 feet from the double yellow center line, which would be roughly 3 feet behind, or back of the sidewalk, if you would, 420 feet of sight line to the right. So in this case here, there would be the back of sidewalk, which I understand is where the planning board would want that measurement taken from now. There would be an excess of 400 feet sight lines with removal of the ledge back to the property line.
Okay. So that would solve the problem.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, and the mailboxes would definitely go in addition to what Mr. Tinsman has suggested about the trees. There are mailboxes right on the left that should be removed from there.
Mr. Griffin, did you indicate to me that those were going to be removed?
I'm working on that. I've talked to two of the people, and one of them myself, and the other one is Tom Hennessy, and I don't think we're going to have any problem relocating that or doing away with it.
We may have to generalize our condition to have that removed also. Or moved, I should say moved. Yeah. Okay. Sure.
I agree with most of what Dick said. I would be absolutely opposed to the proposal as planned. I think many people would be very honest with us about where we would see what we would see out there. And Dick, for the great stroke of having the from sidewalk, but I think it would be true health risk, and I disagree with, or safety risk, I disagree with Dick in this respect, to let a vehicle, the nose of the vehicle come anywhere near the bike path, because if there's a problem and the vehicle has to stop short because somebody comes in front of it, there just isn't any room because you're already out into the street. I'd like to see us require in some fashion, and maybe this falls up on what Greg said, that that doesn't happen anyway because we're on the edge and the vehicle doesn't get out into the bike path, but some way, signage lines, whatever else, assuring the vehicle is well back into the driveway. An alternative to what Dick suggested is to explore a driveway farther over towards the IGA. And that may involve more ledge coming down, but it would also save the tree, and that's an option that we have. A lovely tree-lined main street in Cape Elizabeth, and it's a shame to lose what we have. And we may want to consider, because I know it's not particularly expensive, and in 5 or 10 years it will look like something if we have required some sort of a landscaping plan in connection with this. I don't have a sense of where we could do something. Obviously, we wouldn't do it near the street, or we'd just be planting the problem that we're trying to solve. But it would seem to me that somewhere in the area of the parking lot or in some land, we could, since we've done this with other businesses, do something so that in 10 years we could beautify that area rather than just start the parking lot.
I'd like to just echo what Dan is saying here. We should, as a planning board, think down the road a piece. We've seen two businesses in this area come in for plans right now, but what's going to happen in the future? And this is our only, as Dan said, our only main street, so to speak. So what's it going to look like? Mr. Griffin?
I don't think you were here the last meeting. But on the plan here, there's extensive landscaping, not only on the property line on this side, but also in this area where the rock is. It's low-lying yews and shrubs that won't take away from line of sight.
You're talking about new plantings?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
What about anything of any substance that's set back away? So they replace some of those taller limbs? Is there anything you just back away from the street, the taller trees in the beginning part of the parking lot, parkway, so let's go business.
There are some new trees that were planted along this line that will remain. Plus, we're adding trees here and low-lying bushes over here, and also out in front of the property here, we're putting in low-lying shrubs. The landscaping is fairly extensive, and the reason it is because I requested that it be that way, because I want to give back more than I take, and I want it to be eye appealing, and I just don't want to dig a hole and plant a parking lot and walk away from it. I don't like that.
I guess I will leave it to the planning board members who heard about the landscaping plan. Whether there's more that can should be done, especially in light of removing some limbs of the tree to do that. Maybe that it's fine, and I commend you for the plans you have. I just don't know. It's hard to get you what it looks like.
The two limbs on the tree in question, I think that when I spoke to CMP, they indicated that where they're going to relocate the pole, those two particular limbs would have to come out. Though one of those limbs definitely was not going to be with us much longer, wasn't it? It had a big rotted place on it, and the other one down the bottom had started to acquire some rot. But the main trunk of the tree is healthy and in good shape, and certainly.
Just to review procedure, it may be worthwhile for us to take a look at just the first part of 19.2.9 of our ordinances, just to have an idea of what our choices are tonight. In each instance where the planning board is required, and I quote from A, our scope, In each instance where the planning board is required to review the site plan for a proposed use, which is what we're doing here, it shall approve, deny, or conditionally approve, and I think that's what we're into talking about right now, the application based on its compliance with the standards in section C below, and the standards of what we've been discussing over the past period of time. Doesn't really say anything about the requirement for a hearing, which there isn't one. So I guess at this point, if it is appropriate, I would entertain a motion on this application.
Mr. Chairman?
Yeah.
I would move that the planning board order that the application by Oak Hill Dry Cleaners for site plan approval under section 19.29 be approved with the following conditions. One, that the applicant secure permission to remove two limbs that are closest to Route 77 from the tree immediately adjacent and to the north of the driveway. Number two, that the mailboxes be removed and relocated so that they do not intrude on the site distances to the left. And three, that a stop line be painted sufficiently prior and on the applicant's property or side of the sidewalk sufficient so that no vehicle would intrude into the bike path when it has to stop and look left and right.
Okay. Does everybody hear the motion?
A second.
Does our secretary have the motion?
Most of it right.
Okay. We have a second. Is there any discussion? Dan?
Since we're going to see more businesses there, is it possible for us to go one step farther? There's a bike path sign. It would be nice if there was, in addition to a white line, some sort of a sign that alerted people coming out of, I don't know whether it's too late, maybe we'd get Ms. Jensen to do it voluntarily and certainly anybody else, that alerted people to the fact that stop, bike path, look both ways, whatever we could do, because I think a line is going to be something that becomes the center of the car underneath you that you don't notice. And I really think we've got an obligation given that curve to tell people they've got to look both ways. I don't want to be too simplistic about it, but I'd like to have us come up with some type of signage that meets with our approval, the condition that there be some type of warning sign that we can use as a standard for subsequent driveways. Well, I'm sure Mr. Hennessy probably did something.
Also, lines disappear in the winter.
Yeah.
So that's another reason why you might want to have a sign.
I think it's a good idea, and I would amend the motion so that the condition three that indicates a stop line painted and requires some sort of sign, I don't know what it would say, indicating that there is a bike path there. Is that what you're referring to?
Stop, bike path, caution, whatever. We leave it to you since it's your property, but I think maybe we should say subject to that.
There might be a standard for that type of sign that the railroad.
Actually, we should probably leave that subject to the approval of the police chief, probably, right, in this case.
Officer
Dyer, whoever would be there to police in the situation that occurred, so.
So the motion would read as appropriate and as approved by Officer Dyer of the police department or the police
Let's
department.
Let's say the police department.
I've got another question, too, and Jerry Daigle just raised the issue that it's my understanding that additional ledge is going to be removed as part of Mr. Hennessy's site plan approval to the extent of it going up to the property line. And I just want to make sure that is the case.
That was what was represented to me. Is that the way you understand it? To the yellow stake, the ledge will be removed.
That's where I had recommended.
Yeah. Which is the property line.
Would you want that condition in your...
We already have it as a condition of a previously approved site plan for an adjacent property, so I don't think we need to condition on this one as well.
Any further discussion on the motion?
Just one second. small question. After the removal of the ledge, what do you do to, are you planning any plantings there to hide?
Absolutely.
What could be an eyesore?
We're going to, as you can see in the plan, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 low yews that are going in there.
I see.
Plus, we're going to put a bed in there, probably a peat moss or chips, and we're going to take and box it so that it doesn't run all over the place.
Good. Thank you.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, can we take this for a vote? All those in favor of the motion as read, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It passes 4-0 with an abstention. Okay.
I'd like to take the time to thank the board for the indulgence. I served on the planning board for 3 years. I don't remember ever taking the process of walking across the street for a site review. I totally appreciate it. Thank you.
Good luck with your
good
business.
Luck.
Thank you.
We'll allow a few minutes here, and we'll be ready to move on to our next item on the agenda, which is I. Allen Balfour, request for a zone change from RP to RA zone under section 19-4-9 of our ordinances. Is there a representative, Mr. Balfour, here tonight? Would you please identify yourself for the...
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, my name is William Dale. I'm an attorney in Portland. I represent Mr. Balfour, who is in front of the planning board seeking a zone change. We have on prior occasions submitted materials, hoping to get to a public hearing. At the last planning board meeting, the board requested submission of some additional materials, which we have provided in the interim. I believe we're here tonight simply for you folks to indicate that, yes, you have all the materials you need and to set the matter up for public hearing at whenever is next convenient for you folks. Beyond that, I'm pleased to answer any questions you have.
Thank you. To review procedure, we have received a memo from our planner which indicates that all of the items are in hand and are okay. I'm referring to a memo dated August 5th, 1988. And so we do have a complete application according to our planner. What we are here tonight to do is basically to review that package, see if we have any questions on that completeness. And it's basically only to determine completeness. We're not determining the issue at this point in time. Our ultimate objective will be to either recommend or that the town council act favorably or recommend that the town council act unfavorably, either way, on this application at a subsequent meeting. But we're not doing that tonight. Tonight, all we're concerned about is completeness. So are there any questions on the completeness of this application?
Mr. Chairman, I do. There was a letter in our package from James B. Hansen of 2 Roundabout Lane that questioned the ownership of certain portions of the land. And since that does go to a basic issue that the board wrestles with periodically, right title and interest to be before the board, might we have some presentation on that?
I think the question here was on the road, if I'm not mistaken, from the site tour. There was a question on ownership of the road.
Yes.
Could you address that point?
I'd be pleased to.
And Mr. Chairman, regarding that, if the presentation could address the points, Mr. Hansen's letter, that would help at least me.
Do you know which letter we're referring to? It's a letter dated 2nd August, 1988.
No, I did not get a copy of that.
Okay.
But
we can make one available to you right now if that helps. You can use mine.
Would you like me to run through this first or go through the letter points first?
Perhaps
I'll explain this first, maybe that will answer the points raised in the letter. I'll try and turn around so because I know there's people in the audience on here on this. Excuse the map, but this is mine and it's marked up in color here. Let me orient you. This is Broad Cove Road.
this area in here are the 13 lots of which Mr. Balfour owns that he wants rezoned from resource protection to Residence A. This is the interior roadway through the previously approved subdivision plan. Here is the present terminus of Pine Ridge Road. The ocean is down here on this end of the plan. A question was raised at the site walk, which occurred 2 or 3 weeks ago, as to whether Mr. Balfour indeed owned all of this property on which he's seeking a zone change request. He's been out of town, and I hadn't had a chance to check with him, but I have spoken with him now, and the answer is this. I suspect this is what Mr. Hansen has alluded to in his letter, and that is that another property owner over on this side of the project site, which now Mr. Balfour does not own, has recently purchased this property, and in so doing, purchased some or all of the fee simple in this leg of the interior roadway. Okay. Mr. Balfour, under Maine law and pursuant to his arrangements with this abutter, of course, still retains the right for these interior lots to use that portion of the road and to improve it. But I think to the extent someone has raised the point that Mr. Balfour does not technically own the fee simple title to this anymore, that is correct. And I think probably it would be appropriate for us to amend our zone change request, which technically have initially presented, went all the way to this, I think that southwesterly sideline of this leg of the interior road. We will bring it back to this northeasterly or oceanside sideline. Please understand Mr. Balfour still retains the right for these interior lots to pass over and improve this, but he does not technically own the fee simple title.
So will you be amending your application?
You have a letter to that effect tomorrow.
Okay. Point of information here. We're considering only a zone change here. We're not considering land use questions. So the fact that there is not access to none of those lots is not germane or relevant to this point, I don't believe. I think that's...
When it provides that would be a public road in the area in question?
Yes. As you may recall, members of the board, these final 13 lots are part of the original, 130-lot Broad Cove subdivision, showing Pine Ridge Road coming through here up to Broad Cove Road. Our original zone change request from this February included that portion of that leg of the roadway. Based upon this apparent conveyance of the fee to this abutter, we will now amend our zone change request just to go from the ocean or northeasterly sideline of that leg over here to the end of Mr. Balfour's property. Mr. Balfour and these interior lots still retain the right to pass over that land and to improve it, in other words, to gravel and pave it. And likewise, of course, this doesn't affect in any way his own continuing ownership and right to pass over and improve this leg.
You're saying they retain, or they have the right to pass over that leg,
yes,
the one he no longer owns,
yes,
as a matter of common law,
yes,
because they're landlocked, and without that, they would have no way to get to the street, or what's the basis for that?
Both the fact, well, it's not that they're landlocked, because of course they have access, at least, I think all of them have access this way, but as a matter of Maine law, if you get a subdivision reviewed and approved and record a plat in the registry of deeds, all of the interior lots have a right of passage over the interior streets shown in that subdivision plan without regard to the fee simple ownership of the roadbed.
In addition to the right to passage, does the developer have the right to develop that piece of land that doesn't own to town specifications?
He would have the right to improve it for roadway purposes, for example, putting gravel and tar on it, if that's what.
As needed for
roadway purposes. We wouldn't obviously have the right to put an obstruction such as a building across it. We don't own it.
My question was, are you absolutely confident that you have the right to improve it to the width that may be greater than is necessary for passage? But it is necessary to meet town standards.
We would have
public road.
We would have the right to improve it to the right-of-way width shown on the original plan, which is that shown on this submission plan.
And would the developer have the right to convey that to the town?
OK. convey the right to travel across it,
yeah,
he would have the right to convey the right to travel across it. He does not own the fee simple ownership in it. He cannot convey that. And of course, that's not necessarily dispositive.
I didn't understand that. What did you say?
Mr. Balfour owns only the right to cross over and improve this portion of, I guess it's not really labeled, but this leg of the interior roadway. Okay? He can improve it, assuming we get other approvals and so forth. He can improve it, he can gravel and pave it. He cannot give a deed to the town of Cape Elizabeth for the fee simple ownership in that. He doesn't own it. He only owns the right to cross over it. Obviously, this abutter over here is just as interested in, as Mr. Balfour is in having this be a public road because it provides access to this abutter land.
How does the town acquire that as a public road? How does that get into the public domain as a public road if your client can't get it to the town?
If the town of Cape Elizabeth needs or wants, because of course the town has to decide whether it wants it, if the town wants title to that, there will have to be a deed from this abutting property owner who owns the fee simple and it's subject to Balfour's in effect easement rights.
And can you proceed with the application? And the reason I asked you before, whether you propose that to be a public way without the ability to make that a public way, it seems to be a third party.
I'm not sure at this point. Remember, we're just asking to change the zoning on this. We're not here for subdivision review and approval for these house lots. I'm not sure that Mr. Balfour has made a commitment one way or another about proposing to dedicate this interior roadway to the town. Obviously, that's the normal course and what he would otherwise propose. But if he and Mr. Kennedy, or Mr. Kennedy's company, the adjacent property owner here, can't reach an agreement on that, that portion would remain simply a private way. But I don't think that affects our ability to ask for a zone change for this property, which is all we're here for tonight and future nights.
So you simply amended to exclude that cross-hatch leg as part of your
yes.
request?
This much here, we will have to amend out.
Any other questions on this package as presented? Just to go back on procedure under section 19-4-9 of our ordinances, before public hearing by the town council, any proposed amendment or change we're talking about on our resource protection zone, unless initiated by the planning board, shall be submitted to the planning board for public hearing and recommendations to the town council. Notice of such public hearing shall be given by publication in a newspaper of general circulation within the town at least 7 days prior to the date thereof. And then the town council shall not, within 30 days following the submittal to the planning board, set any such amendment or change for public hearing unless the recommendations by the planning board are sooner received. So I think our next step here is if we agree, and I think we should vote on it, that we have a complete application, we should set a public hearing date. So do I hear a motion on this package?
Mr. Chairman, before we do that, I guess I'm a little bit confused and hate to admit that, but for a zone change request, we have a zone change checklist that a couple of the issues were statement describing consistency with the comprehensive plan and the zoning ordinance, and statement indicating the zone changes compatibility with the surrounding neighborhood and impact on the value of adjacent properties. And maybe those are issues to discuss as we discuss the meat and the merits of the issues, and whether they are appropriate or not isn't necessarily a question for the checklist. But I guess I'm a little bit confused about the road. It was originally proposed as a road. We're not approving a subdivision per se, but we're approving, we're looking at a zone change from an RP to an RA district. And one of the issues in the checklist is consistency with the comprehensive plan. And I guess I'm just a little bit confused whether we can even do that without, and maybe we can, but without the ability to transfer the road to a public road which was originally proposed. And maybe that, again, is in the meat of the issue rather than whether it's a complete application, and maybe that's more addressed after the public hearing.
And I guess, once again, as we have made the statement before, that item on the checklist refers to a statement. I guess we have to take a look and see, is the statement in the package? If it is, then I guess the question is, once we get into, as you say, the meat, the public hearing and discussion, does that statement, is it adequate? I mean, do the planning board members feel that it holds water?
Yeah.
That may be a bad term to use, but in this case, but, you know, and that's, I guess what you're saying is in the meat of the discussion.
That's right.
Any other points of completeness? Do I have a motion on this application?
Yes, despite the questions, you have a motion that this application is complete.
Do we have a second?
Should be considered complete.
Do we have a second?
Second.
All those, I guess, any further discussion? Right, so. No further discussion. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We have accepted a complete application. We will now set a hearing for, I would assume, our next scheduled meeting, which is September 20th.
So moved.
Seconded?
Seconded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? We have a hearing date set. We have made a site tour of this property. If any of the planning board members have not made a site tour, I would encourage you separately to do it. Take a walk down that road so you get a sense of what we're talking about here. And we will have it on the agenda as a public hearing item for the 20th, and will be so advertised.
Mr. Chairman, mm-hmm. Would it be appropriate to request the town's legal counsel to review the question that Mr. Tinsman has raised concerning the ownership issue of the road and what we're going to be doing, and have his comments available for the public hearing?
Yes, I think, but in particular, I think it should be reviewed in light of the applicability to the zone change request.
Yes.
Okay. So we don't get confused with the fact that we're doing something different.
Mr. Chairman, while he's looking into that, I'm very confused. I really wish I had a legal degree, but when a piece of property like this has been changed from an RA to an RP, it is one contiguous zone.
Mm-hmm.
What is being presented to us are 13 little RP zones. And my legal question is, you know, as a person who is ignorant of the law, is when an RA zone is changed to an RP zone, would that not negate the whole concept of lots? Now, I'm sure that someone would come along and use that wonderful word that is used for everything, grandfathering.
Mm.
But I think it's a question that, because it happened before, it's just happened a couple of months ago, and we viewed what should be one contiguous zone as a series of lots. Yes?
Mr. Chairman, could I make a brief
sure.
response? And I won't make it self-serving for Mr. Balfour. Maybe I can just help Mrs. Guthrie. Two separate issues here. One, the legal one about whether we're grandfathered, whether we can put house lots here based upon our prior approvals. That's separate. That we're not presenting that argument to you tonight, nor will we next week at the public hearing or to the town council. That's the legal argument that you folks don't have to concern yourselves with. We're here on a separate policy issue, and that is we think this piece of land should be rezoned from resource protection, and only just the piece Mr. Balfour owns, from resource protection to residence A so we can put houses on it. There, that's a policy decision. You'll look at it from a policy basis, and you'll agree and say yes, or you'll disagree and say no. Similarly, then the town council, with the benefit of your report, will look at solely the policy issue. should we amend our ordinance, just like you might be amending the text of the ordinance, except now you're amending the map, as a policy matter, is this a good idea or a bad idea?
Right, I understand that, sir.
And I don't think that you need to worry. I mean, obviously, I'd love to have you, because we think we have a good legal argument on the grandfathering, but I don't think it's appropriate for me to raise that here tonight or in front of the town council. That's a separate issue. You have the luxury of looking solely at the policy issue. Is it a good idea to rezone this? We recognize there's a fair amount of discretion for you in the first instance and ultimately the town council, which makes the decision here, on that policy issue. You have the luxury, and for us, the disadvantage, is you don't have to look at our legal arguments. We like our legal arguments. You don't have to endure my attempting to persuade you on them.
I can understand that. I know that we aren't a court of law. I am just asking what I feel is a very simple, logical question. And it's very difficult for me to look at all of these maps and look at lots that were created over 20 years ago, abandoned, and now they are referred to as the lots that seemed to be rendered null and void by the new RP thing. So, I mean, you can, I'm not getting into, you know, court, the Supreme Court. I'm just asking a simple question.
Okay. I understand.
Understood. Can we get those questions raised with our legal counsel, Jerry?
Yes.
Okay, I guess we have a hearing date set for the 20th.
Thank you.
And I would, once again, encourage anybody who hasn't walked the site to walk the site.
Thank you.
We are through our old business and ready to move into first of two items of new business tonight. First item is, and we're a little bit ahead of schedule, but not much, Farm and Fish Market Proposed Zoning Ordinance Language Revision. Yeah.
Sounds
like it. Ordinarily, I would like to do that, but we do have people here who are here, I assume, for the farm and fish market item on the agenda.
Mr. Chairman, I think we should leave it on the agenda.
And so I'd like to stay to the agenda. I don't think it's going to be a long discussion.
As chairman of the farm and fish market, mm-hmm. I would support Mr. Boxer's suggestion. It will only take a minute to set the letter of credit amount for Stonegate, and we still have 5 minutes that I'd like other committee members to have the option of being here, so it may be appropriate to do that.
Oh, okay. All right. Has everybody heard Mr. Tinsman's suggestion? If it's okay, I won't take a vote on it. If it's okay with the board, then we will.
Fine.
Then we'll move on quickly to the item, last item on our agenda, and that is Ibis Corporation setting amount for letter of credit for Stonegate Phase 3. Mr. Taylor, you weren't expecting anybody else to appear on this issue for you, were you?
No.
You were jumping ahead 30 minutes.
I'm not expecting anybody else to appear.
Okay. We have received a letter, if I can dig through my file here, dated July 28th, performance guarantee, Phase 3, Stonegate Subdivision, to Mrs. Alice Rand, and was stating an amount of $219,350. And I don't know, did we have anything in here from our town engineer indicating that that was, let's see, adequate? Or maybe you can address that question.
I am unaware of any correspondence. I tried to call Steve Butler to check today, but he was ill and wasn't in.
Sir, do you happen to know whether that question has been raised with anybody?
I see that the letter was forwarded, copy sent, Ibis Corporation, right. Letter was copy sent to Bob Hunter. I received no communication with Bob Hunter. I have not talked with Bob Hunter. I've talked with Steve Butler, but not long enough to know if he talked with Bob Hunter.
Mm-hmm.
And we're here tonight to have this discussion.
Fortunately, without the benefit of staff review.
Exactly.
Well, the okay. Numbers were arrived at on the same basis as the two prior bond amounts, which mm-hmm. was we took our road and utility construction contract from Blue Rock between Blue Rock Industries and ourselves and utilized those figures to come up with a construction cost of $205,000. And then the allowance for potential technical services and potential administrative services have been set as percentages by, I don't know whether that's ordinance or just practice, and it's a simple mathematical calculation to get from the construction total, which is taken from our contract with Blue Rock Industries, to the total performance amount.
Mm-hmm. Any questions on the procedure that the letter entails? I guess as chairman, I'm going to say one thing, that I am a little uncomfortable, not a lot, but just a little uncomfortable with the fact that we have not had staff review of this. Leaves us in a little bit of a quandary here. One suggestion might be that we vote on it with a condition that we do get staff review, and if that staff review turns out to have some problems, that we may have to come back at it. Is that a problem with you?
Well, I would. We'd prefer to have it set this evening, and we submitted the letter on a timely basis and tried to copy everybody who might be involved in the decision process. We think it's a pretty straightforward matter and done in a way that we've done before. What it does is it holds up our ability to market lots in the third phase of Stonegate, because there's a condition on the initial plan that says we shall not offer lots to the general public in any phase until the performance guarantee has been posted. So we would, it is not our intent to post the performance guarantee tomorrow morning. Okay, we're not going to, it's going to take the bank a few days to type up the letter of credit and for us to bring it over here. So perhaps if the board has a, when is the board's next meeting? September
20th? 20th is a regular meeting. We will have a workshop on the first Tuesday, which is
the 6th or so.
6th, yeah.
Why don't we do as you suggest then, and then if there's a problem, we can perhaps address it on the 6th?
Is that acceptable to the board?
I share your concern. Bob's right, it's a mechanical thing, and
yeah.
If you just quickly approve, so maybe we can have a condition that it's approved, but he isn't going to do anything until the 6th of September, and if our engineer doesn't agree with that amount, then on the 6th we take it back.
I have no problem with that. Or just, I mean, if you want to have the advice of the engineer, I suppose just postpone it till the 6th if it's not going to be final until the 6th.
Mm-hmm. Well, if you're comfortable with that kind of a motion, Dan, could you put that in the form of a motion? Or do we?
I'll try.
Okay.
I would move that we approve or we set the amount of performance guarantee at $219,350, subject to one, approval by the town engineer. Two, no action by IBIS to act upon this setting prior to September 6th, 1988. And three, if the town engineer doesn't approve of this letter of credit amount by September 6th, 1988, then we will discuss the matter at our meeting on the 6th, and your inability to act on this bond will continue through that meeting.
Masterful legal.
Do we get it all down?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Do we have a second?
I second it.
Any further discussion?
There is the, of course, there is a matter that the town attorney and the town manager will approve the letter of credit.
The form of the language.
Once you get past yeah. them. Yeah.
Yeah. All those in favor of the motion as presented, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Aye.
Passes unanimously. Sorry we couldn't be complete, but we do need the staff review.
Well, thank you very much, and perhaps I'll see you on the 6th.
Maybe. We'll be out.
This is...
Absolutely. We are now ready for our second to last item, which is now the last item on our agenda, and that is the Farm and Fish Market Proposed Zoning Ordinance Language Revision, Section 19.1.3. We have actually two pieces of correspondence related to that, at least I do anyways. I have a July 29th item, memo to Richard Tinsman from Barbara Barhai, COG Senior Planner. And then we also have a letter to Alice Rand on August, a memo, August 9th, also from Barbara Barhai, on the same item. Mr. Tinsman, could you give us a quick summary of what this is all about and maybe set the stage for what we're supposed to do with this at this point?
With pleasure, Mr. Chairman. Let me back up and maybe spend about 5 or 6 minutes or so and give a little bit of a history to why this is before the planning board. And before I do that, I wanted to tell the planning board what kind of committee they created. We have been, as a planning board, dealing with the roadside stand issue for a couple of years. It was first raised by the Zoning Board of Appeals as a potential issue of concern in the future, and a couple of years ago, the Zoning Board requested the planning board to at least think about it, start talking about whether it was of concern and what we could do about it as a town. That culminated about 6 months ago in a public hearing or a workshop session at which most of the planning board members unfortunately could not attend, and there are only a couple of planning board members here, at which time they found a united front between the farmers and fishermen in the town that were wholly opposed to the language that was then drafted as to what to do with roadside stands. And I don't know that we need to go into the history of that language other than out of that meeting was created a committee of volunteers who devoted themselves to looking at the issue and trying to come up with some answers for what to do with the roadside stand issue. That committee was composed of myself and Marion Guthrie, and though not formally and officially, Greg Cross was there at virtually every meeting from the planning board. In addition, Jerry Daigle and Ernie McVane were at most of the meetings of the committee. Steve Butler staffed the committee, and Bob Hirschen and Bruce Sarbeck from the Zoning Board of Appeals. So from a town standpoint, it was well represented by Zoning Board of Appeals staff and planning board. In addition, a number of farmers and fishermen who get their incomes primarily from those two industries were represented on the committee as volunteers, including Cale Maxwell, who's here this evening, and Rick Marshall, who are here. In addition to that, Bill Jordan, who serves many functions in the town, one of which is as a farmer who's on the committee. Byron Knowles, Greg Griffin, Jody Jordan, Stu Rich, Harry Hardy, Dave Johnson, and Jackie McKegney. There were several meetings of the committee over the last few months, and the committee started with the belief and feeling that there's a history base in agriculture and farming in this town, and that as we reach for the future, we should be trying to enhance our history by keeping some of its rural character, and attempting to bring together both the history and the future of the town as expressed through the fishing and farming communities. It was determined very quickly that the roadside stand issue really had five different levels of concern and consideration, one of those being the card tables that were put out by the people who wish to sell something, whether it's flowers or cucumbers, matters little. The committee decided not to deal with the card table type of operations, since that was more of a police function, and if there were a problem, then the police could ask the child with a lemonade stand or the cucumbers or the strawberries to move the card table. There were the issue of temporary stands, such as we have in the pick-your-own strawberries that are located in town, part of the character of the town, and the committee dealt with those, but not in the sense of being regulatory.
more accepting and understanding temporary stands would exist and not trying to control them. There was an issue as the third level of home occupations, which the committee has suggested language that cements the fishing and farming communities squarely into a home occupation type of activity in accessory buildings or outside buildings. The next level was the fish and farm or fish or farm market, which is the basis of the ordinance changes that are being suggested by the committee. And the next level, of course, is the commercial ventures that the committee determined would be best operated in business zones rather than in what it's recommending in the suggested ordinance changes. It is determined by the committee, and it is recommended to the planning board and thence to the town council, that as a part of the rural character of the town of Cape Elizabeth, that fish and farm markets with strong performance standards be allowed to exist anywhere in the community on an arterial or collector road. And there's one other,
a feeder road.
So there are three types of roads that are listed in the amendments where fish and farm stands could go. There was also the issue of roadside stands, which was the original impetus to the committee. And somewhere along the line, the committee determined that really roadside stands, because it was more encompassing, that it was the desire of the committee to separate out fish and farm stands rather than roadside stands per se, and to provide a greater definition for those fish and farm markets so that we had something tangible, something very specific, that we could attach as criteria so that as we're looking to recommend that they be able to locate anywhere in the community, that there are not only strong performance standards, but strong criteria in determining what a fish and farm market is, so that we don't have commercial ventures locating anywhere in the community under the guise of a fish or farm market or a roadside stand. Without going into the specifics, which I think we can do if you desire, all the planning board members have had the opportunity to look at the amendments, and at least three of those here tonight went through those six or seven or eight meetings and debated the specific issues. We would suggest that the planning board set for public hearing the proposed amendments, and that we have a public hearing next time, at which time the committee, probably through myself, will present graphics and everything else to talk through the performance standards and what we came up with, and then to recommend to the council adoption of the proposed amendments. That concludes my thoughts. We have two committee members here, Mr. Chairman, that you may want to recognize to see additional input, and the two other planning board members who are here that might have some other input as well.
Okay, Mr. Tinsman, I'd ask you to recognize those committee members for me, if you could. But before we do that, I'd like to commend you and the committee for a fine job in this, what started out to be a very, very difficult and testy issue, I know, initially, and has now gone through a process, thanks to the efforts of the committee, that has brought this into a point of discussion for the town and possibly a change in our ordinances, which is the way the process should work. And I think it does do a lot to affect the way the town operates, and does a lot to improve the way hopefully we will be able to conduct these kinds of operations. So if you would recognize those committee members, maybe they would want to say something.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Marion or Greg, do you have any other thoughts and suggestions?
I think you covered it all. Dick did a fabulous job, and it was wonderful being on that committee and meeting new people and discussing Cape Elizabeth. It was very worthwhile.
It was fun. We'll see what happens when the council and the planning board gets through. It's great.
I would only second Marion's comments. She did an excellent job at the committee. The committee did a very good job in taking a long-range view of what they wanted the town to be, and I commend them, and I commend you for your efforts.
Thank you. KL or Rick, any comments or suggestions? KL's never at a loss for words, so.
Well, I can't miss the opportunity to say something, at least to continue my ongoing challenge along this line.
For the record, Mr. Maxwell, would you just identify yourself?
Yes, my name is Kenneth Maxwell. I live on Spillink Avenue and a farmer in this town, agricultural entrepreneur or something like that. I would like to compliment Mr. Tinsman as for his chairmanship. We had a lot of disagreements, but very few fights. And we had a real broad group of people there with a lot of different thoughts and opinions. And certainly what came out of that was not what I had an idea would have. And I think we all felt about the same way, and yet come out feeling as though that what we've got addresses the issue pretty well. I would like to leave just a couple of thoughts with you as you've, you know, in the end result, have got to make a decision whether this, I suppose, goes on to the town council. First of all, I feel as though that this is a very good attempt to address the heritage of the town. The agriculture and aquaculture business of the town has been with us since the first settlers. I think we'd all like to see it continue. And it's got to continue in a little different manner than it did back then. It's got to be addressed according to our present day and age responsibilities and requirements, not only for the benefit of those particular people, but for the neighbors also. And so I think that this does that. Another quick comment is that you hear it, and we all hear it, that the one thing we want in town is to save and protect open space. Individuals want to do it, but there isn't one in a million that's got the finances to go buy 10 or 20 acres just to keep it open for other people to enjoy. But you still do have a few people in town who are maintaining open space, and because, as you can imagine, my thoughts would be more for the farm market end more than the fish. And they have the area out there that's flat sometimes and choppy other times, but because I'm in the farm end, so I have the acreage in the town, and they're not of the stay in the agricultural business. I've got to maintain that as open space. And I'd like to see the town do more as far as saving open space, but that is expensive even on a collective basis. And so those few that are maintaining that for us, even as a business, I think we want to be very, well, sympathetic and to encourage us whatever we can. And I think this generally does this. I could say to you that the 10-acre minimum figure is a lot lower than I thought we would come up with. But if we can get 10 acres kept open without costing the town a cent, that is 10 acres of pure profit. I can see more people taking advantage of the fish farm situation as a home occupation than I can as a farm or fish market, because the requirements, not only site plan review, but a full residential lot in RA, 40,000 minimum in RC, with the buffers and all that that goes with it, it's going to be a tremendous expense for a person to go through just to get the lot, to say nothing about the building and whatever goes on with it. I do not believe we're opening the door to retail markets, which we frown on a little bit, whether you want to say Cumberland Farms or something else, because we're headed towards the sale of raw agricultural products. We're not fish products, whatever it may be. We do not limit it 100% to that, but we certainly do limit it to the extent that if they cease to be the majority of that, the business is closed. As I said, I feel as though that if there are people who will take advantage of this, who will come under the home occupation situation, where they'll have a little business in their garage or something like that, where they'll sell seafood or agricultural products. And of course, you've got your controls already in line for home occupations, and I think that takes care of itself. I see very few people are going to, you know, undergo what I'm beginning to attempt to do, is to get town approval of a full-fledged farm market. I would be surprised if another one showed up in town, but that doesn't say there won't. I complimented the chairman, and I would say that Mrs. Guthrie, I think, was very faithful. I think she came to every meeting, and so you do have two people, and Mr. Cross also, of course, but that on your own committee that were there and saw the thing develop and the agreements and challenges and changes, and Steve Butler and his right-hand assistant, they're the young lady, I can't even think of her name now, but they were crossing out and reprinting pretty regularly to try to keep up with us. So that's all I have. I will certainly try to be here during the public hearing and to attempt to follow this through, but if you have any questions, I'd be glad to try to answer it.
Thank you very much, Mr. Maxwell. Any additional comments?
Rick Marshall, any comments?
Hearing none, I think we do need a motion to set a public hearing on this item. Do I hear one?
I'll move. You and I are a minority and couldn't kill us if we tried.
Right.
I would move that we set it for a public hearing at our next meeting date.
Seconded.
Okay, no further discussion. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? We have a hearing date set unanimously for the 20th. Now, yeah, this concludes our regular business, and before we take a vote to disband for the evening, we do have we've had a light night tonight. We finished on time, which is wonderful, but what we've done is we've pushed a tremendous amount off to September. And I guess what I'm going to ask, with the lack of Steve being here, Jerry, if you can talk to Steve about starting to think about an agenda right off. We may want to think about taking some non-hearing items, if this is possible. I don't know if it's even possible. Some non-hearing type items and putting it to our first Tuesday meeting. Is that going to be a possibility?
First Tuesday of September?
September, yeah.
It's going to be a problem because of Labor Day.
They're sending it back for some minor changes.
You mean on our rules?
At 10 o'clock.
I don't know. I don't know what the result was.
They really did not indicate one way or another what they felt about the 10 o'clock.
It seems as if they're more uncomfortable with the 7 o'clock, given that everything else starts